This is what's called an artificial leaf. It's a solar, like a mini solar panel that has catalysts on both sides that drive a reaction that hopefully you'll get to see.
Maybe.
It's a YouTube video. Do we not have a connection or?
Oh, I don't know if you do.
Okay. Okay, it's, sorry. So if you go on YouTube and you Google like artificial leaf MIT, you'll get to watch this video. What it shows is that they shine light from a lamp that's like meant to simulate sunlight onto this solar cell, and it generates electricity in the solar cell, and it splits. It does this chemical reaction that you see up there, water to hydrogen and oxygen. On one side you have hydrogen bubbles coming off, and the other side you have oxygen bubbles coming off. So there are a lot of people who are working on that reaction. Actually, Ruben here as well.
Yeah.
And then, you know, also in just in terms of project ideas, a lot of what's exciting about solar energy is that you can use it at a small scale. So there are actually solar water purification devices in places of the world where you don't have a lot of clean water. You can use solar energy to purify the water. Something I actually saw in person was streetlights in Haiti. So you actually have a streetlight, has a solar panel on it, and it puts the electricity into a battery during the day, and the lights turn on at night. So in a place that would otherwise be completely dark, suddenly you have streetlights. And maybe I'll turn it over to Ruben.
Basically I think what we work on is like looking at ways to sort of, like creative ways to use like renewable energy, things like solar, to try and kind of like make a difference in the world and kind of like change how we sort of use our energy. Because like one way to think about it, which I always like to do, is if you just think of it like big picture, like the Earth as sort of like just like a mass balance, the kind of source of like 80% of our energy is stuff we take from the ground. And it actually gets put back in there in the form of plants, but the rate at which we do that is sort of imbalanced, and that's sort of not sustainable. So another way to kind of think about it is energy into the system, into our Earth, should ideally come from a more sustainable source. And sunlight is one of them, but maybe like wind and other things are. But the idea is to then find ways to take that energy in and actually make it usable for 80% of our energy needs instead of the opposite. So that's kind of, if you have cool ideas in regards to that, there's a lot of kind of big picture things, but there are a lot of small picture things like making a lamp in Haiti that can do that, that can make a big difference in people's lives. So things like that I think are kind of what we hope to help you guys with, and we're pretty excited to do that.
Cool. Awesome.
All right.
So this is what
this is what the is yep. Helping record.
Okay, so we got hands free. Right. All right, hey everybody. So I'm Dave, my partner Prathima. She can't be here today, so I'll be talking about our interest, which is in visual line biology. Switching gears entirely from the engineers in the audience or the speakers that we've had so far, and looking at really small scale biology. So on the order of cells and molecules, which allow life as we know it to exist. So the title on the slide is microscopy, so I'll be talking about that for now. So it's a little background. I'll kind of begin in the 17th century when they began looking at the same kind of technology that they used for telescopes, but on cells and living things. So first I discovered cells and bacteria, and basically the same technology that they've been using since the 17th century, we now use it in the laboratory, just with slightly fancier tricks to get better contrast in the images and look at different things within the cells. But basically the same technology, except for the people in the 1930s who discovered electron microscopy. Maybe you've heard about some of that things. But basically the same technology that we use nowadays has been around for hundreds of years. And I think that's a really cool way that the same kind of advances have been allowing us to continue to do some really cool looking research. So nowadays the idea behind microscopy is that we can look at specific things within the cells, rather than just put a cell underneath the microscope and say, what does it look like? What shape is it? And now we actually say, is this thing inside the cell, and what is it doing, and where is it going, and how fast is it moving? And so some of the ways that we can do that are with chemical stains, where you put a chemical onto the cells, and it hones in on certain parts of the cell, so we can look at like how big the mitochondria are, or where the DNA is inside the cell. Or we use antibody stains, which we can design to make anything in the cell kind of light up, which is really cool when you're looking at if there's a certain protein you're interested in, which has some connection to cancer or another kind of a disease, to see how much of that protein is being made in the cell, how quick is it degrading, and things like that. And also, fluorescent in situ hybridization, it's this technique where you can look at specific sequences of RNA or DNA to see where inside the nucleus or inside the cell that those are locating, which is super helpful when you're figuring out how many copies of DNA are there and things like cancer and applications like that. So these are some of the really cool images that we're able to get using these techniques. Let's hear some chemical stains of nuclei, which allows you to count specific cells, see how many cells are there and how big nuclei are. Cytoplasm, where you can see actually in tissues you extract from an animal or a human to see like how the cells are organizing themselves. With the antibodies, you can look at surface markers to see if the blue cells are, let's say, one type of blood cell, and the red cells are another type of blood cell, how they're interacting, where they are they attached to each other, are they interacting at all? And at the cytoskeleton within the cell, just see how the cell is organizing itself, and how it's structured, and how it's moving around in space. And these are videos that actually Prathima, my partner, took in her lab, where you see all these little pink bacteria are zipping around inside of the cells that are stained green. You see them multiplying and zipping around and kind of moving, how they're interacting with the cells and each other. And here's this phase contrast microscopy, which is looking at just the cells in dish, seeing how they're wiggling around and touching and talking to each other in space. Okay, thanks. Okay, so that's just some project ideas that we were throwing around. Is looking at these microscopic worms or amoebas and seeing how they're interacting with their environment. You can actually look at them over time and see how much they're eating and what they're attracted to and what they're not attracted to. And just moving on. So my interest is in genetics. And kind of history of it, it's much neuroscience with, I think, a more incremental advancement. Where in the early 20th century, we figured out what DNA is. In fact, it is what is controlling the cells. And nowadays, we've been really good at reading out the DNA. Actually, now we've gotten really good at modifying DNA, which is the next future direction of the science. And so I'm interested also in directed evolution, which allows us to take a pre-existing protein and give it a new or enhanced function. And this is not just a thing that I'm interested in. It's a thing that everyone seems to be interested in, because a scientist from Caltech about a year ago won over $1 million from a foundation for kind of leading the charge in the direct evolution field. So some examples that you might have heard about is that we now make insulin, which every one of you makes in your own cells. And we get bacteria to make it for us now. This fluorescent protein that comes from a jellyfish, now we can make other organisms express it and just make them look kind of goofy, but also make certain cells express this protein. And golden rice, we're taking the vitamin A gene from certain organisms, put it into our food supply to make it much more healthy for humans. Then I can talk about these. I can talk about this later, but we can also get bacteria and yeast to express genes that we take from other organisms as like antibiotic resistance and that sort of thing. So some ideas that I've been thinking about is directed evolution and looking at microorganisms and human health also, see how those interact, where human cells and maybe microorganisms are interacting, and see what's actually on your body and how different people with different genetics have different microorganisms with also different genetics. So that's it for me, and hope to talk to you guys later.
Okay, we're gonna take a quick stretch break. It's been a lot of science today, so we're just gonna a 2-minute stretch break. So if you wanna like stretch or close your eyes or open your eyes. We'll be back in 2 minutes. Don't go anywhere.
I didn't.
Okay.
So we can,
I think your picture didn't even show up.
Yeah, my picture didn't show up.
I deleted it.
You're like, I don't like it.
No. It just was a big X.
Oh, okay, that's good. Yeah. I see the things I try to change these
deleting
things
it would
a different
be better
set,
than having a big X.
So I figure we can do.